It's been described as challenging, dangerous and extremely expensive, but the fact of the matter is that rallying is still a very popular sport in this country. A rally is a timed section of closed road over which a driver and co-driver must complete as quickly as possible. The fastest time wins. In order to do this, he needs a rally car. These machines are designed to be faster and safer than a normal road car, which means preparing and funding these cars isn't easy.
Well, first of all, thing when you come home from the previous rally, the car is unloaded, and the first thing it does is it has to go to the wash and be all cleaned and that there, and then it comes up in here, up into the garage, and as you can see, it's put up on stands like this here. But that's the normal procedure. But if you had any wee problems, to take it for a drive, the mechanic, to see could he hear it, if you had a noise or gearbox or something, he'd take it for a drive before it comes in here. But generally, when it's from a normal rally and no major problems, you just come in here. Then, as you can see, it goes up on the stands, and then he'll then go through it, and he has a checklist, and everything has to be ticked off to the next rally, from engine to brakes to gearbox to brake lines to even simple things, the lights and all, are for scrutiny reasons and that there, and just a basic full over check, so it goes. We have a man that comes and looks after the car, and he's a professional in this here sort of trade, so he knows, just leave it to professionals, that he knows where he's at. But then on the day of the rally, obviously, we have our own team of boys coming to help, and they assist, because you'd be under a lot of pressure the day off a rally, but our boys assist with that. Well, obviously, as everyone knows, it's a high cost involved. The fuel's probably the biggest cost. It's about £3 a litre, so it is. It's very expensive, so it is. And then the tyres, there's a lot of makes of tyres. There's Dunlop, there's Cumo, there's Michelin, and now it's back to BF Goodrich. But they range in price from, say, €150 to €200 and something. It depends what brand you're using. And then as it goes again, it depends how hard you are on the car. If you're not too hard on the car, you can get away very lightly between rallies, like, and then it's just, as I say, the expense of the fuel, but in around probably £1,000 to £1,500 for running the car or rally.
In addition to this, there is the safety features that a driver must wear and have on his car.
Well, before even getting into the car, the safety features of it, the driver has to be all kitted out with helmet, obviously, boots, and then he has an under layer in underneath his rally suit then, and the rally suit's 3 layers, so you've really 4 layer, and then the balaclava and gloves. The driver's got a lot of equipment to wear, and then, as you can see from inside, there's all the roll cage bars, every car is equipped, and it for a car goes to a rally, it has to be scrutinised to make sure all this is up to the World Rally standards, like all these cars go through standards to make sure they're up. And then every car is equipped with fire extinguishers, and that's main safety features.
So you have your car and all your equipment, but you're still missing something. A co-driver is a driver's biggest aid in safely navigating through a rally stage, and his job is no less difficult than that of the driver.
Quite forced and check the routes and make the pace notes. So what we normally do, the driver would call the road, the degree of the corners and the distances all to me first, and I'd write everything down as you'd be driving through the stage, and then the second time round I'd read everything back to him as you're coming to it. And the biggest part of it would be for the timing, to make sure that you're calling each corner as you're coming to it, but not too close to it that you're going to go off, you know, so you don't need to be giving the driver too much information. So it's just sort of drip feeding him to know sort of where to start slowing down and where to keep going on, you know.
Time's a bigger aspect of it.
The timing will be the biggest part of it, you know, because at the same time, if you're starting to be calling pace notes late, the driver's going to lose confidence in you, and he's not going to really be listening to what you're saying anyway. So, you know, as you're coming to the thing, you have to make sure you're bang on the time to tell him slow down or to where the corner is and everything, you know.
Would you believe that this here is the most important piece of equipment between the whole car and landing? Because this here is what the navigator tells the driver where to go. This has got everything in it for the stage. It has got, as you can see from this here, it's the corners. The corners go from a right and a one right the whole way to a 6 right or a square and a hairpin. Well, obviously, a 1 right's a very little corner. It's just very small, whereas a hairpin's obviously just the complete opposite, back in yourselves. And obviously, lefts work the same way. But then you have all the... You can make your own notes in it. you put in your cautions where you think is a wee bit dangerous, big danger or dangers, and then you have the distances is a big thing. You have like two right, 40 square right, so the driver knows he's only 40 yards to get slowing. Distance are a vital thing, and having the navigator calling them at the correct time that the driver needs them is just vital. Or number one, to avoid an accident, and number two, if you want to be competitive, that's what you have to do. The navigator and driver have to be working 100% together, so do. And that's what you do on your Saturday before the rally, the national rallies. You get a map of the roads and you go along, and then you make out your own notes like this here, your corners, your distances and everything. A lot of things people that don't have much interest in rallying is don't understand, like when people say, oh, I was on the wrong tyre or something, or they just don't understand the difference between, oh, how could you be on the wrong tyre if it's black or something, like it's a tyre. But there's clearly not different when you look at the three of these here, like that. You'd use the likes of that tyre, they're just completely on a dry road, so there's no really cuts in it. And then this here, it sort of goes up, then if the road gets a wee bit more wetter, you put the cuts in it, and then that lets the water out, so you have better brake in that there in the car, you're more control. And then if it's raining really heavily, then you cut the whole tyre out, because when you're going into puddles, then these here grooves here, they let the water go out, they slice the water away, so that there helps you go faster, but it's obviously for safety too. So it's just trying to get the right, as you can see, there's not very much between them there, like it doesn't look much between these two, but it's a big difference when you're actually rallying, like it's a very big difference, just them extra cuts, what it can do, it's unbelievable, the difference in them. And then, well, hopefully we don't have too many days like that there when you're using that type of tyre, because that's very wet, like that's the extremes. Would you believe that there is the same tyre, it's just cut, we have just cut it, or you just cut it so you do to suit the conditions, like that's that there tyre there, cut into the different grooves. And then obviously if it gets warmer day, you'll have to go a harder compound tyre, and then you wouldn't be cutting them because it's dry, like, so you'll always be using a harder compound tyre if it's dry, because the road would just eat the softer compound tyre away, like, so you have to go harder, depending on the air temperature and road temperature, you have to get all that into consideration. As mentioned earlier, these cars, they just don't run ordinary fuel, it's high octane fuel, so you just can't go into your normal filling station and buy it, and plus for safety reasons, it's not going through the side, so it goes in through the boot, and there's a special pump you get, and obviously put it into the drum, and then you just have to fill it in here through these here pipes. And then because it's so flammable out there, that reduces the risk of fire and out there too. That's another major safety feature because all it's secure in there.
One of the main attractions of this sport is the camaraderie and general family feel of it. It's a sport where friends are easily made and where help is never far away.
Absolutely. I mean, like, you know, certainly in Irish rallying, camaraderie between us all is fantastic. And, like, you know, a lot of my mates here, like Niall and all, like, oh, Adrian, there's a gang of us, really would know them all only for rallying, and, like, you know, it is great. That's a great social side to it as well, like, you know. But at the end of the day, look, we all work. It's something what we do as a hobby, and, you know, when it's all over, we all go to the pub and reminisce and have the crack.
Just the whole team, like, there's so much of a team thing behind it, what people don't realise, so much of a team, and you're not just winning for yourself, you're winning for that five or six boys that you're with, and it just gets a really close team, and that's what I love about it. Obviously the family, but then there's about five or six real good close friends are in, and they're going to everywhere, Skibbereen, Cork, weekend upon weekend, and coming home and results aren't good, like, and they go again, like, and just keep pushing and pushing all the time. That's what I like about it.
Money has a massive influence on the sport, and there is no getting away from the fact that the recession has had a big effect. But it's not all bad news.
Well, I think it's sort of getting back to the way it was a number of years ago, you know. During the building boom and that, you had every builder in the country was buying a rally car, and everyone was doing it, you know. But there's an awful lot of people now the people that are doing it now are doing it because they genuinely love the sport, you know, and they're scraping up money and trying to get a few pound together to do a rally, you know, whereas there was other guys a number of years ago just throwing money at it, and, you know, it didn't really matter, and might not necessarily been all that talented, but had big wallets, so. Ah, well, the ones that they were in, like, they had to go to England and that to get work done, and, you know, but it was crazy there for a number of years, you know, you couldn't get entries, and it was the people at the lower levels, the young boys starting out, that couldn't get the entries, and you had these other checkbook rally men, and they were all turning up and doing the rallies and going on ahead. But now it's getting back now to the way that it used to be, where people doing the rallies now are more fanatical about it, and they're working at the cars themselves, and you know, you've a lot of guys doing it now that would be getting a good buzz out of finishing the rally, knowing that they spent their own time preparing their car and getting it ready and going out and competing in it and finishing the rally. You know, they get a great buzz out of that.
I believe that the National Championship is just going to keep on getting stronger and stronger, because maybe in the last few years, even before it went, it was still a strong championship. But now the international, they're very costly too, because you could be away from the Tuesday before the event and you're rallying for 3 days and you're wrecking, like making your note for 3 days. Whereas the National Championship, you can just leave on a Friday night and then you're home on a Sunday night and you're back for work. You're not taking time off work, and it's just one day wear and tear in the car. And that's it. So I think when the championship's like that, they're still going to stay strong and the competition's going to be good. I think it's going to be a good championship.
Well, obviously we're in a bad climate at the minute, but like, you know, in fairness, rallying is holding up relatively well when you see what's happening all around you. Going forward, like, you know, I think there's a lot of good young talent coming up there. Probably the world cars, as we see here, are probably have their day. And I think, like, it's going to be Super 2000, Group N. I think that's going to be the way going forward.
So there you have it. Rallying remains a very popular sport with competitors and spectators alike. It's fast, exciting, and always guarantees entertainment. You still not convinced? Well, here's the main reason these guys compete.
I used to play football, and then when I just first sat in the rally car, it's just the complete adrenaline rush and all you get, and the speed.
I think it's just the buzz you get out of it, the adrenaline rush. It's like, it all I've been doing it now for 25 years, and like, you know, it's still hard to beat the buzz when you get to the end of a stage and you've set a good time. And like, you know, I think it's like any sport that you get into. I think, like, you know, you just get addicted to it.
You don't even feel the pain. You don't.